Welcome to Rancho Capistrano. This is where I come when I need nourishment for my soul, where I come to think and to pray and to draw close to God. The reason we're filming here is because something happened here. As I prayed and thought about Hour of Power, I realized that Hour of Power is much bigger and can be much bigger than we ever dreamed. Traveling a lot as the pastor for Hour of Power, I get to meet all sorts of people. So we travel around the country, we'll go to the Netherlands and Australia and Hong Kong and all these places, and over I hear these incredible stories of people who say, Hour of Power completely changed my life. And these aren't like people that said, I learned a little bit about the Bible. We're talking people who literally were gonna kill themselves and didn't because of the Hour of Power. People who decided to start a business or save their marriage or actually came to faith in Christ, or maybe they were hurt by religion and came back to Christ. And as I meet these people, whether it's at our local church or traveling, I start to remember the church. The church is not a local event. The church is not a building. The church is people, and it goes all the time. The church is us right now. As we continue to build an Hour of Power, I think about the church and how Hour of Power ought to reflect that fact, that we're the church, that you're the church, and so am I. Over the next 6 months, we're going to create a new format that puts this global church on display, that goes outside of a building and outside of an event and goes right to where the church is happening in the lives of people. I believe that if we do this, that there are going to be people that are flipping the channel that have said their whole lives, this church thing, it's not for me. This Jesus thing, it's really not my thing. And then they actually see Christ and the Holy Spirit like being lived out in people's lives, in their actions, in the places that they work. I believe that there are going to be people that are watching the program that think for a minute, maybe, just maybe, this Jesus thing can be for me. And so to all of you who are watching around the world, those of you who have been a part of this program for 20 or 30 years, I want you to get excited with me and believe that there are people out there who've never thought that faith would be something for them and now believe it somehow because of this program, that it might be something that could actually be lived in their lives. And to all of you who have continued to support us and love us and write to us, I just want to say, thank you, and believe in the future of the Hour of Power, because exciting things are ahead. Welcome to our new program. We are so glad that you get to see what we think of as history. This is the first episode of a new program of Hour of Power in which we are completely changing the format and the way we shoot the church. Up until this point, the church has always been, in the minds of so many, an event on Sunday morning. But today we're beginning something entirely new. Today we're shooting the church as it happens outside of the building and inside of the building. We're shooting what God is doing in the lives of people wherever they are, and that is the church. Because of all of these changes that we're going through in Hour of Power, today we've begun a new series called Who We Are. It's easy in all of these changes to forget our true identity, what makes us who we are. And so we're going to be spending the next 5 weeks talking about the vision of this ministry and the kinds of people that God wants us to become. We have an incredible experience today. We're going to get an awesome interview from Jay and Katherine, who went through a horrible experience 6 years ago when Katherine had a stroke and almost died. And they're going to talk about how you can have hope and how you can even be happy in the midst of real suffering. They have an incredible story. We also have some amazing music. I'm going to be sharing a sermon based on that new series. And up next, we get to hear that traditional hymn that so many of us love so much, but sung in a new way. It's Holy, Holy, Holy.
God, come on.
Up next, we're going to talk about our vision, which is to create happy and whole students of Jesus. This is something that has really been my heartbeat for a long time, the idea that believers ought to be happy and whole. Oftentimes, as I talk about this, people say, when you say like happy Christians, does that mean like some fake guy smiling all the time, even though inside he's really broken and hurting? And no, that is not at all what I'm saying. The kind of thing I'm talking about is an almost impervious ability to be happy and joy-filled because you have a real passion in your heart. It's just like when you walk home as a dad and those kids run at you and they like put their arms around your leg and they scream with joy because dad's home. It's that kind of love that creates in us a deep sense of being happy and whole students of Jesus.
Well, good morning. Thank you for being here this morning. And for all of you who are watching on television, if you're ever in Garden Grove, Orange County, if you're ever at Disneyland, hop on a bike and ride down to our church. We'd love to see you. Today, we're beginning a new series, as you can see, called Who We Are. As we go through a number of big changes in our ministry, we want to make sure that as we embark on this journey of a new hour of power, of this, you know, continuing to move in this church space, all of the changes we're going through, that we remember why we're doing it. We remember what our vision is, and we remember who we are. We're also beginning a new program for everyone here and on television called the Curriculum for Christlikeness. So every sermon that I'm going to do this year, I've actually prepared in advance all the way through July the 18th of 2015. And in order to do that, the reason we did that is we put together a curriculum called A Curriculum for Christlikeness. That was written by Dr. Bill Gaultier, an understudy of Dallas Willard, a dear friend of mine, a mentor. And he is going to be a second voice offering us insight, a follow-up study to the things that we do here in this church. So everyone watching on television and all of you here in church, we want you to take this free gift. So if you're watching on television and you want to participate in what we're doing, write to us or go online and we're going to send that to you for free. It's really cheap. It's not like a really nice looking book. That's why it's free, right? But it's material that will help you. For those of you that are here, that are maybe in a small group here in the local church, or maybe you need a devotional, this will be for you. Now, I'm sorry to say it's not done yet. It'll be done in 2 weeks, but when this goes to air, it will be done. So we will have these hopefully for you here in the next couple Sundays. And we want this to be a regular program so that if you participate in the worship service, you'll be able to take this curriculum and it'll match every sermon and theme for each service. Isn't that great? So, okay, and hopefully that will help us as we continue. The reason we're doing curriculum is because of our vision, and our vision is this: to create happy and whole students of Jesus. And students require curriculum. You know, a student has a manner, a method in which he or she will learn a certain thing. And so today we're going to begin this conversation of who we are. And who we are as a church, as Shepherd's Grove, we are happy and whole students of Jesus. That is our dream, right? So sometimes we're fragmented, we're not always whole. Sometimes we're very sad and depressed or unhappy or cranky, and you know, we're not happy. And sometimes we just, you know, forget about our faith and fall behind and backslide. Okay, so not all of us are always going to be this way, but this is the vision. This is the dream. We want to be the kind of place that when people come here, they say, forget Disneyland, Shepherd's Grove is the happiest place on earth. You know what I mean? We want to be the kind of church. We want to be the kind of church where people come here and they're happy for a reason. We're not talking about like fake, bubbly, my life is falling apart, but I'm going to wear a fake mask. We're talking about people that have a deep sense, a deep abiding sense of joy, peace, and groundedness. We believe that only comes through a relationship with God, because all of us have this deep hole on the inside, and if we don't fill it with the Holy Spirit, we try and cram stuff into it, stuff that's good, stuff that's a blessing. We morph it and mutate it and corrupt it so it'll kind of fit in this hole, and that's when things like addictions and hurrying and restlessness and anger start to form in our soul. And so that's not the kind of person we're talking about. We're talking about people that are studying and dedicated to following Jesus and allowing the joy, the peace, the groundedness to sort of emanate from our lives. So we want, when people come through those doors, to experience happy and whole students of Jesus. So we're going to spend some time talking about that the next 5 weeks, and let's dive right in for today. Before I read the passage, which is from Matthew 13, if you have your Bibles, you can open them up. Before I read the passage today, I want to think, Bill mentioned this in our curriculum, the idea of what kids do to parents when they get home from work. So many of you are moms and dads, you have, especially when you had little kids, maybe a 2, 3, 4, 5-year-old, and the garage door opens, and you get out of your car, and you go, and your kids come running at you. I mean, this happens to me. It's the greatest feeling in the world. I open the door, and my kids come running at me and saying, "Daddy!" You know, and you're kind of like stinky and sweaty and tired, and then they just hug your legs with their fat, pudgy arms and fat fingers and like chubby cheeks, you know. And what that does to the heart, you know, the heart of a father or a mother when their children, or maybe if your grandparents, your grandchildren, when they do that, "Grandma, Grandpa!" And one of the questions we're asking you this week is that your heart for the Lord? Is that, you know, Bill mentioned, he said one day he came home and his little daughter said, 433 seconds. And he said, "What is that?" She said, "That's how long I've been counting for you to get home, and you finally got here." So when we talk about happy and whole students of Jesus, we're talking about the kind of happiness and joy that little children have when their parents or grandparents come in the house. You can have that kind of joy for the Lord. When we talk about joy and happiness, we're talking about the kind of passion that young lovers have as they walk through the streets of Paris. When we talk about happiness and joy, we're talking about something you almost can't even help, something that just emanates from you because you are in love. That's what we're talking about when we say happy and whole. So the passage we're reading today is from Matthew chapter 13, and I want to give special thanks to a pastor in New York named Tim Keller, as well as Bill Gaultier and Bill Doctrum, who contributed to the writing of this sermon. In Matthew chapter 13, verse 44, Jesus says these words. It's caught in a chapter, Matthew 13, which is all about the kingdom of heaven. And Jesus, and the kingdom of heaven doesn't mean necessarily heaven. Kingdom of heaven means the kingdom of God, God's reign. It means everything God's doing. He says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had bought, sold all that he had and bought that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. When he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it." That's our passage for today. A little historic context. So first, you get this idea of a man, probably a servant, who's in a field and he finds a treasure, right? Now, this is something that was kind of a, it was almost like a legend, you know. In the first century, very dangerous time, especially before the Roman Empire, you know, Israel was a place that would be often war-torn, violent. You would have raiders, you would have thieves. You even read the stories in the Bible. Back then, they didn't have the banking system that emerges in 15th century Italy that we practice today, where people make deposits and it's guaranteed by the government and safe. No, I mean, you just have money and it's on you. And so what people would do if things got a little bit dangerous is they may go out to a field somewhere, some land they own or something that's sort of unowned, find a random tree, dig a hole, and like Heisenberg, Walter White style, bury all of their treasure in this field and hide it. So that when everything kind of mellows out or if they need some money, they can go to their hole and find it. Well, very often, or not very often, but sometimes what would happen is these people would die and never tell anybody where the treasure was. And so there was all sorts of legends, you know. You always know a friend of a friend back then who was out, you know, in his garden or working, and all of a sudden he's digging and he hears a thump. And he starts to undig it, and all of a sudden he finds some jars filled with silver or something like that, and you know. And so I imagine it a bit like lottery stories. We all probably know somebody who knows somebody who won the lottery. It was like those where, my sister's grandpa won the lottery, by the way. He won $32 million. Anyway, so I'm always like, oh man, you know. Anyway, don't play the lottery. So it's like that, you know, like a legend. You hear about it. You don't know anybody, but you hear about it. And Jesus says it's kind of like that. There's a guy, like probably, it didn't actually have a parable, but there's a guy, a servant. He's out in the field, he's probably working the land, digging or something, and thump. He hears something, he's like, oh my goodness. He has a chill go up his spine, you know. His kind of blood comes out of his face, and he wonders, am I one of the lucky one in a million that found buried treasure in this cheap land, you know? And he digs it up, and he finds this huge treasure. He thinks, oh, I need to buy this. Buries it. He goes and liquidates everything. Maybe he sells his house, his laptop, his DVD collection, you know, his car, everything. He gets rid of everything because he has to scoop up enough money to buy this piece of property because he knows if he can acquire this property, well, then everything in his life is going to change. And so even though this man, and I need you to hear me here, gives up everything, he does it with joy. Because even though he's liquidated everything he owns to acquire this property, he knows what he's getting. And he does it with a smile on his face. Jesus says this, then kind of doubles down. It said, there's a pearl merchant. He knows everything about pearls. In Jesus' day, pearls are just emerging as this great treasure. They're kind of new on the scene. There's pearls in the Red Sea, but those are kind of junky pearls, and so most people have to go to India or different places to find beautiful pearls, and then some of these pearls are worth a tremendous amount of money. As a side note, Cleopatra was said to have had the two largest pearls in history, and the largest one was supposed to be valued at 25 million denarii. Which is the same amount as about $4 billion U.S. dollars. She had one pearl worth $4 billion. So pearls had a tremendous amount of value. And he paints a picture of a jeweler or pearl merchant in a market or a wholesale market, and someone offers to sell him this pearl at a price he knows is very low. And even though it sounds very high, he knows there is a buyer out there who's going to pay 1,000 times what this guy's asking for. And what does he do? For the pearl of great price, he sells everything. He has to go and sell everything he has. He has to get rid of all of his stuff and his cart and his donkeys and his horses and his house. He has to sell everything just so he can get this one little pearl. And people around him might think he's crazy, but he's a pearl merchant. He knows. He knows this one little pearl is worth 1,000,000 times all the other junk he's carrying with him. And what does the Bible say? With joy, he sells everything to get this little pearl. Everything. Now, this is a picture, of course, of what it is like for a human being to find the kingdom of God. To find Jesus and his way, I would be willing to sell everything to get this pearl. I would do everything. You know, many of us, and maybe you felt this way when you sort of came to faith or religion or whatever, maybe, you know, your girlfriend dragged you to church for a while and you started coming for some time and you thought, you know what? You know, we're going to get married, we're going to have kids, I might try this religion thing out, you know? This kind of sounds like it's for me. And a lot of people, when they come to faith or come to religion, they say, you know, I'm going to come to religion, it's going to be like a yoga class. You know, it's going to be a little bit of hard work, but it's going to benefit me, you know? It's like going to the gym or like, you know, it's like my new, South Beach diet, you know? Like I'm going to, you know, to varying degrees, you know, I'll apply myself and if it works out, it does, and great, and I'll improve and that'll be nice. We think that we're going to give a little and we'll gain a little, that there'll be varying degrees, but what Jesus says here is no, that's not what happens at all. You lose everything to gain even more. You die so that you might be born again. It's messy. You cannot experience the joy and happiness and life of Jesus unless you give it everything. The cost of this buried treasure The cost of this pearl of great price means that you sell everything to attain it. Nobody tries Christianity. It's not something you try. Nobody tries death, and nobody gives birth a whirl. Death and birth, by the way, which are both very, very messy. Have you ever seen someone born? You ever seen a baby born? It is slimy. There are all sorts of various colors and liquids. It is screaming and crying and blood and knives. It is a mess. Being reborn is not as simple as the baptism that we have here on Sunday morning. There is a lot going on in the soul of the individual who is born into the kingdom of God, and it is very often a mess. You see, God is both awful and awesome. See, that's the thing we forget. We remember God is awesome, but we forget he's awful too, in a way. Bill Doctrum talks about it. Both words are rooted in the one word, awe. That God is awesome in the sense of the things he gives and the things he blesses us with and the beauty that he makes, but he's awful in what he requires. He's dangerous. He messes with people. God is awful and awesome. That is who he is. Keller called it the radical bad news of the gospel. That you can't just give a little. You have to give it all. It's all or nothing. It is a leap. It is a total devotion. There is no varying degree to death and birth. You are either born or you are not. You either die or you do not die. You do not try Christianity like a yoga class. It is messy. It is radical. C.S. Lewis writes it this way. He says, imagine yourself as a house, a living house. God comes in to rebuild that house. This is when you're saved. At first, perhaps you can understand what he is doing. He's getting the drains right. He's stopping the leaks on the roof and so on. You knew that those jobs needed doing, and so really you're not that surprised. But presently, he starts knocking down the house about in a way that really hurts abominably and does not seem to make any sense. What on earth is he up to, you ask? The explanation is that he is building quite a different house from the one you thought of, throwing out a new wing here and putting on an extra floor there, running up towers, making courtyards. Though you thought you were being made into a decent little cottage, but he is building a palace. And here's the great line. Why? Why is he building a palace? Hear me on this. He intends to come and live in it himself. Yeah. This faith thing, we Christians, we're awful and we're awesome. Like our God. We require in this church devotion, passion, care, life. We require that you give all to the Lord so that you can gain this great, great treasure. And so many of us have to ask ourselves this question: what do we need to sell? You know, we want this treasure. This is our vision, to be happy in a whole people. We want that, right? But many of us are not willing to make the sacrifice that requires true happiness, true life, and true wholeness. What are you not willing to sell, not willing to give up? What is that one last little thing you are holding on to? You may say, oh, it's not, I've given it up. Let me tell you something. If you were never uncomfortable in your faith, then you probably didn't give something up. When you become a believer, when you enter into the kingdom of God means the reign of God, that he's the king and you're not. It means that the queendom and kingdom, the kingdom of Bobby Schuller, ends. This crown comes off of my head and it goes to Jesus. And he's going to ask me to do things that I'm uncomfortable with because that's not how I ran things. And so there are going to be things that I maybe read in Scripture or hear in my life of prayer that I feel like that doesn't make me feel very good. And so I'm going to just kind of like take that thing and put it over here, and then the other bits I'm going to do really well. Well, that is not a change of authority. That is not a man or a woman saying, Lord, everything that's mine is yours. And even though I feel uncomfortable, I'm going to trust you. So let me ask you this. Do you ever feel embarrassed about your faith? Especially for those of you who are, you know, in the university, for example, or in the sciences, or maybe in business, and you're around friends, and you sort of secretly don't really want them to know you're a Christian. Have you given it all? And hear me out. I'm not talking about being, you know, rude and weird and everything, but I mean, is your faith woven into your work? And Jesus says, I will acknowledge all of those before my Father who acknowledge me, but anyone who denies me before men, I will deny before my Father. Very often, we are like that guy, that married guy, who's talking to the cute girl at the counter pretending that he's not married. You know, some of you are like that with your faith. You kind of secretly hope people don't find out that you're a Christian. This happens all over, and increasingly in the West, it is becoming more difficult to be in the world that you work in, or even with some of your friends, to know about your faith. But Jesus needs people to shine their light and show that they really are for him. And maybe there's other areas of your life you've said, I'm comfortable giving my life to God except for certain areas, like my money, or like my sexuality, or like my gossiping, or my anger. I reserve the right to continue to yell at people. And many of us, we have these little things that we say, okay, I'm giving away like 90%. But what that means is that you haven't really given over authority. You're still king. You're still queen. And I'm asking you that if you want to be a happy and whole student of Jesus, it's time to hand it over to the Lord and trust that what he wants for you are courtyards and towers and gardens, not a happy little cottage. And tearing down the old house to build up a new one is going to be quite a painful and messy experience. How has your posture been for God? Is your posture one of a person who is passionate about your faith and this thing that God is doing in your life? That's the kind of joy we're talking about. That's the kind of happiness we're referring to. We're not talking about the happiness that you get because, you know, you want a Ferrari in Vegas or something. We're talking about, like, the passion and life and joy that a lover has. Look at the posture of lovers, the way they look. They don't seem to care, like two people that are in love, they don't seem to care about anything. That looks good. That's nice. It's very sweet. Look, they don't care about what anybody thinks, do they? And they are happy. They're not wondering what people think, even though people are going, look at those guys. PDA! PDA! PDA is public display of affection. So, you know, like, you see these people doing this kind of thing, and, like, they don't care what people think. They just shrug their shoulders and love each other. What is the posture of your life and your radical relationship with a good and loving and passionate God? You know? Most of us, I think, feel more like an old married couple ready to get a divorce than like two young lovers in Paris. I mean, it's the latter, it's the passion, the life, and the love for Jesus that makes us happy and whole students of Jesus. It doesn't come from trying harder. It comes from knowing him. And that's the only way. Many of us, we feel like we ought to repent of things like, you know, I made this mistake, or I, you know, lied about this, or I, you know, gossiped about this person, or whatever. And we have these events that we repent for, but that's not, I think, and it's good to repent from those types of sin, but that's not the best kind of repentance. The best kind of repentance is to repent from a cold heart towards God. That is where it begins, because if your heart is warm and on fire for the Lord, well, man, all that other stuff is going to take care of itself. We need to become people who say, Lord, I knew you once, I loved you once, but I've become cold in my heart, and I say to you, here it is, I am so sorry, and I want to passionately seek you and be with you again. And if you do that, oh my goodness, the Holy Spirit will overcome your life, and you will be filled with such joy and rapture. It's waiting for you. Right now, it's waiting for you. We're asking that as we journey these next 5 weeks, that we're going to remember both in our formation, both in this community, the community of a church, and in our mission, helping our neighbor, that that idea, that principle of passion would come to life. Let's pray. Lord, we are trusting that you are good, and we are asking, Father, many of us, we say, our hearts have become cold. We've become weary in doing good. And so, Lord, I ask that the power of your Spirit would fill this building and that your life would dig and burrow deep into the soul of every individual here. Lord, we are asking you to return to this house, to tear down its walls, to rip out its piping, and to build for yourself a palace in which you can live. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
If this message was meaningful to you, we want to send you our new curriculum. It's a study guide for the Hour of Power. Dr. Bill Galtier and I have worked really hard on creating a study guide that will go hand in hand with every single episode for this television program. We're passionate about creating happy students of Jesus, and we believe that students have a material that they study. If you really feel like, I want to take this program to the next level in my studying, we want to send this to you. Now, some of you, you may just use it as a personal devotional. Others may use it like for a small group, or like if you want to gather friends together and watch the Hour of Power and then follow up with something. This study guide will be really helpful to you. We call it a curriculum for Christlikeness, and we would really love to put it in your hands. It's free, but the content that's in the inside, I think, will really make a big difference in your own sort of personal journey and devotion. Please let us send it to you. Write to us. I want to hear from you, and I want to get this in your hands. Coming up next, we have an interview with Jay and Katherine Wolf, who went through a horrible experience 6 years ago in which Katherine almost died from a stroke. They were living this magical life in Malibu, where she was becoming a model and he was in law school at Pepperdine, and everything seemed perfect. And then all of a sudden, their life seemingly was almost destroyed. And so they're coming today to talk to us about this journey and how they were able to press on through real suffering and come out on the other side, refined and renewed by the life of God. Jay and Katherine, thank you guys so much for being here today with us. You have such a compelling and awesome story, especially to people that are kind of going through it. And we have a lot of people like that watching on television, going through very difficult times. Your life was changed in 2008, 6 years ago. You were going to Pepperdine, right? You were modeling, you guys were in the entertainment industry, and something traumatic really happened to both of you. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about that.
Absolutely. I was having just a normal day, nothing out of the ordinary, and out of essentially nowhere, I put my son down for a nap, began preparing a meal, and just felt funny, and ended up collapsing to my hands and knees. And my hands, feet, legs went numb, began vomiting, and was shortly thereafter taken to UCLA Medical Center, where they recognized that my brain was herniating down into my spine, and I was having a brainstem stroke. And after 16 hours of micro brain surgery, I lived, which was miraculous. I mean, no one lives, and the doctors couldn't believe it. But they had to compromise a number of things to keep me alive, including my facial nerve, a lot of stuff, actually. And I have been on a journey ever since. But what's fascinating is that I was never supposed to go on this journey. Yeah. From day one, they didn't think I would progress or get off life support or ever eat food again or walk again or anything. And then slowly but surely, no accident, one day at a time, things kept progressing and progressing and progressing, and they kept saying I would never do this or that, and I did it all over and over. So I just kept getting well, and he was in the wings all along for every moment.
Well, Katherine was rushed to the hospital, and when they got her into the emergency room, they saw that her brain was being pushed down into her spinal column, which is almost unsurvivable, and this was happening because her brain was bleeding. She was having a massive stroke, and it was due to this malformation called an AVM in her brain that she never knew she had, but she had had her entire life.
And a birth defect, if you will.
Yeah. And And anyway, they really went back and forth whether they could even do the surgery because they knew the liability and the cost to the hospital would be great. And this God-sent surgeon was on call that day named Dr. Nestor Gonzalez, and he went back to his office and he felt, he didn't know what it was within him, but he felt that he needed to give her a chance to live, this young mother and this vibrant 26-year-old woman. And he performed the surgery, and it took 16 hours, but sort of against all odds, he helped save her life. And I know that was God just nudging his heart to give her a chance. And as doctors in our lives have said, you know, the laws of nature really had to be suspended for her to survive, much less to recover. And so it's been a gift to just see God answer the prayers of so many people in this circumstance, because not everybody gets sort of that, the prayers answered in the way that we have. And we haven't gotten a lot of those prayers answered ourselves. So it's this opportunity to just continue to trust in what the Lord's doing.
You know, so you really are a miracle, right? I mean,
yes.
It's a miracle that you lived, and yet at the same time, you still have these disabilities.
Exactly, it's fascinating. So I have no memory whatsoever, although we don't necessarily know if it was unconscious, but I have no memories for almost 7 weeks.
Wow.
And then I woke up after taking a really long nap, and everything had changed. I was a normal, active, happy young mother, 26 years old, and suddenly I'm hooked up to countless machines in a hospital and severely handicapped. And I mean, it was quite tragic to realize that this is my life now. And my son was being taken care of by sweet family members because I was no longer mothering, and it was tragic. And I couldn't eat food. I had a tube in my stomach where Jay would feed me for the next 11 months. And I was just thankfully not in a place yet where I could process how bad this was, because I don't think I could have handled it. God was gracious to not allow full understanding, probably, because it would have been too much to potentially get out of bed, relearn to walk, relearn to eat, because it would have just been too jarring, I think.
I think one thing that a lot of times people don't understand in a scenario like yours is everyone knows Katherine suffered tremendously, but a lot of times people forget how much the spouse suffers in the midst of that as well.
Yeah.
And sometimes it can be, even though it may not be harder, the suffering part, it can be harder in the sense that maybe people don't recognize what you're going through.
You know, like I totally agree.
Yeah, so it's like my wife is, you know, almost died, and you know, now I'm caring for my son who's a baby, and you know, all these dreams and things we were gonna do, and now all of this weight is on my shoulder.
Yeah.
I mean, what do you say to that?
It was it was a challenge stepping into this role of full-time caregiver, you know, medical advocate, father and mother to our kid. Just to all of a sudden be wearing all of these different hats to take Katherine's place, which I couldn't.
And we should add, we have amazing families who poured into our child, took care of him. We have 5 sisters between the two of us. Our mothers were new at empty nesters. We had people come around our baby.
It took a village for sure. But I do think, you know, for all the caregivers out there, there is this sort of sad, challenging space that we live in, mm-hmm. because the attention, the focus, the empathy often goes with the person who's the patient, as it should in so many ways. And yet, it's sort of a lonely road feeling so much of the weight of that loss and that pain, mm-hmm. while at the same time, the responsibility of having life go on. Mm-hmm. I mean, even to this day, people will say, oh, Katherine, you know, your story, you know, when I'm standing right there, or people don't see the perspective that this is the story that happened to us.
Yeah.
And when you're coming together as one, as a married couple, what happens to your spouse happens to you.
Absolutely.
Even if not physically, it does in a very deep experiential, spiritual level. I didn't have a stroke physically, but I might as well have,
yeah.
for the suffering and the pain that it brought into my life.
And he was there the whole time. So I have this massive stroke, and then I'm, yeah. knocked out for a, yeah. long time, and slowly, I mean, taken years to cognitively come together. He was staring at the waiting room floor for years. I mean, yeah. he's been
and
through
the trauma. And
oh,
sure.
And yet, you know, what a gift to be able to experience through suffering the very nature of Christ.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Jesus is nothing if not a suffering Savior, mm-hmm. you know, giving his life for people without gratitude and thanks. And, you know, to get to taste a little of that as a spouse coming alongside your loved one who can't do anything in that moment to pay you back. Maybe, you know, you don't get any credit for like the long, painful hours waiting, but to be molded more into the image of Christ in that process has been such a gift.
Yeah.
And I think the process of caregiving is that, if we have eyes to see it as such, you know, this chance to know what it is to be Christ to somebody else, mm-hmm. and to sacrifice in a unique way. So it's very challenging, but it's been a great gift.
It's still challenging, yeah. too.
You guys have completely, essentially transcended in a way. I mean, it's still a part of you, but now you're almost using it in a way that's meaningful. And tell us about that. Like, so you have this ministry now that has sort of blossomed out of this horrible experience, and it's a ministry about hope.
Exactly. They say your misery becomes your ministry, and I kind of always thought, like, okay, sure, but I get it. Like, you have to steward your sufferings, and what's this all for if we can't share and can't encourage people with what we found to be true? And we talk a lot about, we've just got this thing, this assignment from God, and we all have it, mm-hmm. and we got one shot to use it. And how are we going to use this thing? And God tells us, I think it's Psalm 16:6, that the boundary lines have fallen in pleasant places, that it's a good spot to be in. It's a good place. So what are we going to do? Well, perhaps the charge of all of our lives is to take it, whatever it looks like and however messed up it is, and steward it, and share about it, and say, you too can gain from this little messed up, broken thing called my life.
And it's about, you know, redefining a lot of what the world thinks things should look like, what good things should look like, what healing should look like. Mm-hmm. These pictures are not what the world would think of.
We can be happy and whole even in the midst of being broken in this world. That's what the kingdom of God is about, right?
Totally. And wholeness is, by correct definition in the upside down kingdom, nothing to do with the condition of an earthly circumstance.
Yeah.
I think it's such a mistake to base our happiness on what's happening here and now.
Yeah.
I mean, Paul says very clearly he learned to be content in all circumstances, and that was from jail.
Like, yeah, in Philippians. Yeah,
in Philippians, the notion that, first of all, it's learned. He learned the secret. I think there's a lot of power in what we take captive, what we use, what we let in. But also, he's happy.
Yeah.
Like, how can he be happy?
Yeah.
He made the decision.
So you would say to those watching, don't despair, don't give up. Mm-hmm. There's a brighter tomorrow. You can be happy again. You can be whole. Yeah. You will press through, and suffering is just, it's going to happen, right? It happens to all of us. Well, thank you both so much, Jay and Katherine. We just appreciate you guys so much, and we'll be praying for you, believing in what you're doing. People, of course, can find you on our website, and I'll put a link to your website on our Facebook. But we're just so thankful for you, and be praying for you and believing that. I loved what you said, that our misery becomes our ministry. I think that's true for everyone, and I think you're teaching people how to do that. God bless you.
It's going to be.
They say that depression from infertility is one of the hardest ones to deal with.
We had this life plan that we had laid out, and I think it was actually for three kids, right? We used to say it was for three kids.
You expect something to happen, and you hope that it's going to happen, and it doesn't happen. And you just feel that there has to be some other reason why. There's some bigger presence out there that is in charge of things.
We grew up in agnostic households, both of us, so it's not that we were atheists or we didn't believe in God. It just wasn't really spoken about. It wasn't really an issue in our household. Infertility sort of threw us for a loop, and for the first time in our lives, we really started looking around and thinking seriously about religion and praying, and found our way to the Hour of Power on TV.
We were going to do a fifth IVF cycle, and we were going to pull out all the stops, going to take the medicines, and I got the stomach flu, and I couldn't do the cycle, and we had to cancel and lose our deposit, and thought, okay, well, this is it. You know, we're not going to be able to do this anymore. And that same month, we found out that I was pregnant. We were at our lowest point, and now we have three kids. Didn't know if we would ever even have one. I don't like to tell people, oh, it's okay, you know you're gonna have a baby, like you'll have a baby, because they might not. You have to get to the point where you know that whatever happens, that you've done what you can do, and God will give you what you need. It might not be what we want, but it'll be what we need. Because God blesses all of us.
If you're in sort of a spiritual crisis and you're looking for hope, it's really the right place to be. You want to hear that all things are possible with God. You want to hear that God wants the best for you. That's exactly the kind of message that we needed at that point in time. I came to Christ through the Hour of Power. That's how it happened for me.
We found that there is hope, that you know, there is a plan. God has a plan for all of us.
We're one story of one family that this program has changed the very course of our lives. I can only imagine about all the other stories out there.
You've just heard one of the many stories that we get to hear all the time. Someone who says, this program actually changed my life. The reason we're able to change lives through this ministry is because people like you give and support. Very often people think that, you know, that commercials are sold and that's just kind of how we pay for the TV and the expensive stuff that we do. In truth, we're able to do this because people like you support us and say, we believe in this ministry. So we want to say thank you to all of you. It makes all the difference in the world. As we've been talking about at length in this ministry, we are passionate about making students, people who are regularly attentive to what they're learning in the faith. And so we want to finish every program by essentially sending you home with a new spiritual discipline. Think of it as almost like a homework assignment, something to implement into your own personal devotion. Today, I want to talk about the posture of the body when we pray, when we meditate, when we worship, whether it be corporately or privately. The body matters in the way that you interact with God. A lot of times, we don't think it does. It really does. Martin Luther spent a great deal of time talking about this. He believed that when one prays, one ought to stand, eyes to the sky, hands folded. Now, he wrote extensively about different methods that we ought to implement, and is there a right or wrong way that we posture the body? Not necessarily. rather what I'm asking you to do is think about when you pray, when you worship, whether you're at church or whatever, that you think about what you're doing with your body, because it really makes a big difference. There was a very, very interesting speech by Ann Cuddy on TED Talks in which she talked about the nature of the body and how it affects the mind. So she starts by sort of looking at nature and seeing the animals in the animal kingdom, ones who are sort of defensive and unsafe, do things with their body that sort of like protect themselves, and then animals who are like out and about, maybe trying to win over the opposite sex, or who have just had some victory, you know, you see them be big and boisterous and their body goes outward and up and out, power moves. And she said what she noticed is that human beings do this as well. Like if you see a guy in the Olympics, the first thing he does when he crosses the finish line, arms out, right? Chin up, looking to the sky, a sign of victory. You also see the same thing when people feel like they're victims or whatever, or they're in a horrible scenario. You'll see very different. They're crossing their arms, head down, touching the neck, postures of weakness. So she decided to look at this in a lab where she would have people do power postures before something like an interview, hands on the table, you know, taking up a lot of space, this kind of thing. And then people who would do weak postures, you know, arms crossed, this type of thing. And she saw that the chemistry of the brain changed based on the posture of the body. There really is something to this body having something to do with this mind. And so what I want you to think about in the next week, when you pray, when you worship, think about what you're doing with your hands. Think about what you're doing with your eyes. Think about whether you're standing or sitting. Think about what happens when you kneel. And incorporate into your prayer life intentional motions of your body, postures that go in line with what you're trying to accomplish in your prayer and in your worship. Friends, beloved, we're so thankful that you journeyed with us today. Know that your soul is healed and your sins are forgiven. And we want you to know that we love you. And so may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.